Today, we're welcoming a special guest, Chiho Kaneko. Chiho's a member of the board of directors for Fairewinds Energy Education. She's a visual artist and journalist. Chiho worked for some time for the Awate Nippo daily newspaper in Japan. Since the Japanese earthquake and nuclear accident, she's traveled to Japan four times. One of those was to the Fukushima prefecture. She's joining us today to talk about her experiences and insight. Chiho, welcome to the show.
Hi, Kevin. Thanks for having me.
And as always, we have Arnie Gunderson joining us. Arnie, welcome to the show.
Hi, Kevin. Thanks for having me. Hi, Chiho.
Hi.
So, Chiho, let's go right to you. If you could start by just talking a little bit about what it was like in northern Japan before the March 2011 accident.
I was born and raised in Iwate Prefecture, which is one of the six northeastern prefectures of Japan. Iwate is north of Fukushima. In fact, Fukushima is the southernmost prefecture of those six. And that region is generally considered to be rural by an agricultural, big mountains, beautiful rivers, and beautiful coastal lines and fishing grounds. Sort of like New England of United States, because it's considerably colder compared to the rest of Japan.
So Chiho, it sounds like New England with the mountains and the coastal, except that in addition there's earthquakes and tsunamis.
Yes, that's the case, and that's too unfortunate too.
So Chiho, setting aside the obvious effects of an earthquake, how did things change in northern Japan after the accident?
Well, first of all, the earthquake and the tsunami completely devastated the eastern part of those six prefectures, Iwate, Miyagi, Fukushima, for the most part. And the earthquake actually took place off the coast of Miyagi. So, it was very close, and thousands of people died in an instant. And people's lives got completely destroyed, and a lot of people relocated, trying to rebuild. But then, on top of it, the fallout from the reactor came. And now, all those debris and rubble on the coast, some towns cleared it. But in some areas, like in Fukushima, they're still sitting there because they're highly radioactive. And the big issue today in Japan, this is, throughout Japan, is that how to deal with those debris and rubble, because nobody wants to accept in their incinerators. By burning, you end up sort of spreading the radioactivity throughout Japan. And yet, it's almost impossible to process all that debris within those small regions. And people's lives are completely swept under from their feet.
You know, Jill, we had spoken about this issue of incineration almost a year ago on the Fairewinds site. And there's two concerns. There's the concern of what goes back up into the air, and then separately, what stays behind. The ash from the incineration is highly radioactive too. And so now the Japanese have a waste problem. But then when they get rid of the waste, they send some up into the air and then some down as ash. So it's a problem that doesn't go away.
Yes, that's the case. It is because of the amount of the debris. This is a huge, huge problem. To give you some sort of an idea where my home prefecture is, my parents' home is in Morioka, which is right in the middle of the Iwate Prefecture, which is about 150 miles north of Fukushima Daiichi reactors. So even in Morioka, some foods, such as, say, wild mushrooms or wild greens are found to contain above the limit in some areas of cesium, radioactive cesium. And so school lunches, even in my home prefecture, a lot of school lunches are being tested every week to make sure that the radiation level in the ingredients are low enough, safe enough for children.
And I imagine this, you know, weighs heavily on the minds of the Japanese. Quite a shift from being able to just go to the market and buy fish to going to the market and not knowing if the fish you're buying is radioactive or not. How are the Japanese coping with this sudden change?
Well, some people worry more than others, just like anywhere else. I think a lot of farmers are concerned about what's in their food. And in Morioka, there is the organic food store, just a purveyor of local organic produce and such. The owner, Mr. Ojima, actually set it up on his own, a food radiation testing equipment. He did that in the summer of 2011. That was quite early. And so to ensure that he could provide food produce to his customers, and by saying that, okay, I've tested this food, so you can, you know, you can see what's in there. And people can also bring the food they want to have tested to his store for nominal fee and see exactly, you know, what's in that food.
Well, that's fascinating. You know, you go to a supermarket and, you know, you might have the light bulb aisle and you might have the, you know, the meat aisle, but here's a guy with a scintillation detector in his supermarket. That that really changes the atmosphere in the store. You know, it would be like taking an apple from New England and having it checked for PCBs because it was near the Hudson River or something like that. It's a pretty amazing concept that a store has to do that.
It's not that common, actually. I wouldn't say that the majority of people in my hometown are that concerned about it, to be fair, because most of, you know, major supermarkets, they don't exhibit that kind of information. However, things are much different in Fukushima Prefecture itself, where I had visited just for the first time the other day. There, you know, you see everywhere in a store, I mean, even in just a major supermarket chains, you see, okay, this food is tested and it didn't have the radiation above the limit. So the kind of food that people used to eat, or people are used to eating in those northern regions, it's sometimes no longer available. For instance, people might still use them and pick and eat them, but wild mushrooms are one of the worst things in terms of radiation contamination. For some reasons, they seem to pick up a lot of cesium. So those, a lot of times, you know, wild mushrooms contain higher levels of cesium, 134, 137. And that's the case in Iwate. And so you can imagine what it would be like in Fukushima. And also, if you talk about agricultural products, let's say in Fukushima, persimmon, it's a fruit on a tree, and persimmon is one of their major agricultural products. And the town of Date, where I visited, is well known for their dried persimmons. However, not only the persimmon fruits themselves contain a lot of radioactive materials, but also the traditional way of preserving them, which is to dry them, you know, in the air naturally, actually concentrates the cesium. So those products are completely now off the table. So what happens is that you not only you can't eat the food that you're used to eating, but also you are in danger of losing the traditional ways.
You know, Chiho, there was also just recently a scientific study that showed the cattle that had been left behind to just roam through Fukushima Prefecture were loaded with cesium, and that the concentration of cesium in the baby cattle was 50% higher than in the mother cows. And that makes sense because babies are growing so much faster, and the cesium concentration, of course, goes to faster growing organs. But it's all over the mushrooms, but it's also in the meat of the cattle that were left behind in the prefecture. It's got to be sad for the traditional farmers who've been at this for a long time.
Yes, well, it's actually not just the cows that were left behind, but also this was during the year of 2011. But a lot of cows and cattle was fed the contaminated hay in the immediate aftermath of the accident, and farmers at the time, or even the government, wasn't aware of that sort of things. I think, in a way, you might say it's a common sense, but nobody really paid much attention to the hay. And what happened was the cows and cattle that ate the contaminated hay, which were basically, people leave hay outside over winter, and they just keep feeding their livestock. The cows that were fed hay that were left outside during the accidents, they all found to contain fairly high level of cesium. So there was a massive, massive beef recall that took place in 2011 in those northern regions. For a while, the beef was completely banned from that area, including Iwate.
I think what I'm taken away from hearing you is the things we all take for granted, breathing fresh air, drinking fresh water, and going down to the creek and catching a fish. You can't take that for granted anymore. Is that the case?
That's the case. In a way, it's really sad because I walked all over Japan, northern Japan, and I went to Fukushima for the first time. And at some point, I had this realization that by just treading on the contaminated soil, I'm actually transporting radioactivity to other places. And it's really sad to think that it's not about labeling Fukushima as the place that you don't want to go. It's not that. It's just the reality that the northern Japan, not just in Fukushima, but northern Japan is contaminated. That's a reality. And people are just transporting the contaminants whenever they travel elsewhere. They're bringing with them. And it just occurred to me that when the hoof and mouth disease outbreak occurred in Japan some years ago, the government spent a lot of efforts in containing that disease. And in a sense, they basically cordoned off the entire area and checked monitored every single vehicle and people who are going into the area. Well, you cannot see radiation easily. So what's happening is that there's a gradual and constant dispersing and spreading of radioactive materials inadvertently. Nobody wants to do it, but we're all doing it. That's a really creepy, macabre feeling that I had when I was in Japan.
There was a person in one of the prefectures to the north who wanted to give a message to Tokyo Electric. Can you tell us about him?
Yes. One of the most disturbing things in the aftermath of the triple disaster in Japan was that there's a lot of frustration and anger, naturally. And if it's for tsunami and earthquake, you can sort of direct your anger to nature, but also ultimately you say, well, that's just, there's nothing we can do about it, and you move on. But for the, in the case of a reactor accident, you don't know who to blame. Well, you do blame people who promoted nuclear power, maybe, but also, there are so many conflicting emotions and interests and people basically fighting among themselves. I mean, they're fighting with their neighbors. They're getting upset because your neighbor got compensation, but you didn't. That sort of things. some mothers feel like they cannot financially relocate. So they stay and they accept the fact that they're going to live with the radiation. But then others feel like, well, they cannot, you know, sort of subject their children to potential health risk. Hearing all those conflicting information and emotions, I was very disturbed. And then one day, I read this in some kind of an email, the group email that I subscribed to, that there was this person, one person from Fukushima, carried a bag of dirt from his home in Nihonmatsu, Fukushima, walked incrementally because he has some day job, and then maybe took a little over a month and walked to TEPCO headquarters in Tokyo and delivered the bag of dirt. And his intention was that, well, you know, maybe it's illegal to transport radioactive material, but in that sense, it's ridiculous to really control something like this because it's everywhere now. And he felt like, well, he didn't ask for this bag of dirt. He wanted them to sort of feel what it's like to be surrounded by things that you didn't ask for. I was struck by such a simple, honest act of plea that this man did. So I ended up sort of communicating with him, thanks to my friend, and I ended up seeing him for the first time the other day, which was quite an inspiration. I visited him in Fukushima.
Chiho, can you talk maybe a little bit about the polarization that's going on with the Japanese public, how some people have accepted this problem, while others still feel that it may be not patriotic to talk about this problem?
Yes, that is a very, very complicated issue. It's amazing that, you know, how attached people are to the place where they live. And even though most people are aware how badly contaminated their town is or their home is, it is very difficult to shed that attachment. And they hold out hope for returning if they're, you know, evacuating, that sort of thing. But then what I find is that the mothers with small children especially, they seem to have very different take on the reality compared to the rest, because they are the direct link to life, you know, the future. And they feel like if they don't do something about protecting their children, nobody will. So they're the ones who say, well, you know, the government is really not doing enough to, you know, help people move to a safer place. I would say farmers have mixed feelings about the situation. You know, on one hand, they might feel like they didn't ask for the this contamination, so they're very upset, and, you know, they're trying to get the government to compensate for the loss. But also, they too want to sort of restore the land if there is a way to do so, so that they can continue to live there and continue to grow food. So everybody has slightly different priorities, I guess, and take on the situation. And that's exacerbated by the fact that there are conflicting analysis, interpretation on the health effects of radiation.
So there's lots of room for disagreement.
Yes.
Chiho, what do you see as the future of northern Japan? Where does everything go from here?
I don't know, to put it simply. Well, if you read the paper, a lot of headlines are very positive, you know, sort of a news of recovery of, or news of, you know, reducing radiation levels and et cetera. But those news, the headlines are often interspersed with, okay, the other day, another, you know, food item was found to contain above the limit, you know, cesium or whatever. So now it's off the table, that sort of things. And a lot of people are suing the government and TEPCO for various reasons. So I really don't know what's in store for the future.
I think we are at a lull between two storms. I think we had the, you know, the first storm of the immediate after effects of the accident. And frankly, it's too early to get the cancers yet. you know, the latency for thyroid cancer is a little more than 5 years, and the lung cancer is, you know, 5 to 10. So I think we've seen this horrific accident, and there was, you know, anger and fear. And now we're in this period when, you know, maybe it's the eye of the storm, but the next wave is coming. And, you know, what my concern has always been is that people were needlessly irradiated. And now, of course, unfortunately, the Japanese are going to be reporting higher than normal cancer rates. That's going to be life in Japan for a long time to come.
One thing that some people are very concerned about is, of course, you know, what's going to happen to their own health. Some people that I've met, they experience already some kind of a ill health just by simply living there. I think a lot of people have this anxiety about what's going to happen to them. So those people are also concerned that they're going to be sacrificed and forsaken ultimately, because apparently in Chernobyl, a sort of government suppressed the study that connects people's sickness, illness to their radiation. Official study indicates that the health effects were not that bad. And so people in Fukushima feel like the same thing's going to be said about them in the future. But then reality actually might be different. So those are really palpable anxieties and fears that I sensed while I was in Japan.
You know, let me just talk to that just for a split second. There's a symposium in New York City on March 11th and March 12th. We'll have more information up on the website. But while the official sources are quoting one line of thought, in fact, there's a large group of scientists who've already documented problems developing in Fukushima. You know, these same scientists documented problems in Chernobyl. And some of them were actually thrown in jail for 5 years in Belarus as a result. So when I hear about the official numbers coming out of Chernobyl, frankly, there was such a massive cover-up in the Ukraine that I don't believe any of the official numbers. And I think this time is different. We have a chance using the Internet and citizen scientists throughout the world to really document what's going on in Fukushima, like we never did at Chernobyl and like we never did at Three Mile Island. So, you know, that's really why we started the Fairewinds website and why Chiho's on the board of directors, is to, one, keep the public aware, and to, two, get the public's information so that it can be disseminated through symposia like the one in New York City in March.
Well, Chiho and Arnie, thanks so much for joining today. It was a pleasure.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kevin.
And that about does it for this week's edition of the Energy Education Podcast. You can catch us back here next Sunday and every Sunday for more on what's happening in the world of nuclear news. Also, don't forget to like us on Facebook.